Dear students, today we will discuss about the inorganic free radicals. So, actually, what are free radicals? Free radicals are the atoms or molecules which contains one or more unpaired electrons. They are very reactive because of the presence of the unpaired electron, and they are generally paramagnetic in nature. So, all the free radicals, I am talking about all the radicals, all the free radicals, they are having the unpaired electrons. So, they are paramagnetic in nature, and generally they exist in gaseous or liquid phases. Free radicals are found everywhere in the air, in human body and other materials around us. And they are responsible for deterioration of plastics, paints, degradation of artworks, and they sometimes causes some diseases like heart attack, cancers, and illness related to aging. Besides this, free radicals, they are also useful in industrial synthesis like cracking, pharmaceuticals, chlorination, polymerization. And they are the part of very important reactions in our bodies. If we are talking about free radicals, so free radicals are very important in our biological systems also. Many are necessary for life as they kill bacteria inside the human bodies. So free radicals are very important species which are responsible for protecting our life from bacteria inside our body. The most common oxygen-centered free radicals are superoxide anion, hydroxyl radical, singlet oxygen, hydrogen peroxide. And within the mitochondria, actually, superoxide anions continuously formed. Okay, so these are helpful generally. But excess free radicals generates inside the body due to the oxidative stress. So if any kind of stress is there, then excessive free radicals can be generated, and excess amount can cause diseases to our body. There are actually the certain number of mechanisms to reduce the radical induced damages, and we also take sometimes the antioxidants to reduce the negative activity of these free radicals in our human body. So this is all about the free radicals, because the free radicals are very important. I have told you that in human body as well as they are industrially important, and generally they are the intermediates during some reaction. So they have very important role in industrial as well as in human body. So it is a very interesting topic, and we are dealing with the inorganic free radicals. Let's study about these inorganic free radicals. The radicals can be defined as atoms or molecules or ions with unpaired valence electrons. The valence electrons may be one or more. Okay, so it should have the electrons, unpaired electrons in its valence shell. Now, radicals have one or more dangling covalent bond. Okay, so like OH, CH2 and NH. So, it is having one dangling covalent bond which can form bond with hydrogen radical to form H2O. So, it is generated from H2O, and one electron is showing the dangling covalent bond. It is having two unpaired electrons. This is carbene, and it is having two unpaired electrons. So if the free radicals, they are having two unpaired electrons, then they are known as diradicals. And another example of diradical is oxygen. So oxygen is having two unpaired electrons in its valence shell. So it is again a diradical. And due to these dangling bonds, they are very reactive. So through this dangling bond, it can easily form a bond, covalent bond with the other free radical. They are paramagnetic in nature. They are paramagnetic. Why? Because they are having the unpaired electrons in their valence shell. They exist in liquid and gaseous phases. And most of the free radicals, they are short-lived, and a few are long-lived free radicals. And maximum are short-lived free radicals. Then they play important role in polymerization, biochemistry. As I have told you that there are a number of free radicals generated in our body, and there is a mechanism to can act as antidote against them. So they are very important in our body system. Atmospheric chemistry, as you have studied about the balance between ozone and oxygen in the atmosphere, that is taking place through radical reactions. Okay, and that balance is now disturbing due to the chlorofluorohydrocarbons and gaseous exhausts from our vehicles. Then it is important in plasma chemistry, cracking, chlorination and combustion reaction. So these free radicals, they are very important part of our this industrial processes. Now we will study about the difference between ions and free radicals. So what is the main difference between ions and free radicals? If we take the example of ions, then ions carry a charge. They may be positively charged or negatively charged. So they may be cation or they may be anion. So due to the charge on these ions, the number of electrons and protons are not equal. So electrons may be less or more than the number of protons. Okay. Now they may be monovalent, bivalent or trivalent. So they may have one positive or negative charge, they may have two positive or negative charge, or they may have three positive or negative charges. They can be solvated easily. This is the most important property of an ion, that they can be solvated due to electron pair interaction. So if we dissolve NaCl in water, then we will find that this Na plus ion will get hydrated, and this can surrounded by the water molecule having their negative pole towards the sodium ion. And this chloride ions, they are surrounded by the water molecules, and their positive poles will be towards the chloride ion. So this is the way how this sodium chloride can dissolve in water. So at even high concentration of ions is possible in the polar solvent. So if we dissolve this NaCl, and we can form the concentrated solution of this NaCl even in polar solvent. So this is the main property of ions. Now we will talk about the properties of free radicals. Free radicals cannot be solvated. Radicals have unpaired electrons. Okay, so they have no net charge. So if they have no net charge, then the number of protons and electrons are equal. So these are entirely different from that of ions. So free radicals cannot be solvated or hydrated. For solvation, solvent molecule should also require unpaired electrons. So if the solvent molecule is having the unpaired electron, then only the free radicals can be solvated. The free radicals can combine to form molecules. Actually, if we take the free radicals in a solvent, then these free radicals, they are very reactive. So they react and combine with each other to form the molecule. So we cannot find any free radical at high concentration in any solvent. So this is a case, like this is fluoride ion. So in case of fluoride ion, there are 10 electrons. Okay, so it has 10 electrons, but the protons are 9. Okay, so this is an ion, while in case of fluorine there are 9 protons and 9 electrons. Okay, so no charge is there, here is negative charge is there, so this is an ion, and this ion when dissolved in water, so the positive pole of the water molecule, it is towards this fluoride ion, so that it becomes hydrated. Now this is fluorine, so this fluorine cannot exist in water or solvent, because one fluorine will immediately react with the other fluorine, because both are the free radical type species, so that they will form F2. So it cannot be solvated easily. So this is the difference between ion and free radical. Now we will discuss about the important aspect, important property of a free radical. So these important properties, they include stability and reactivity of free radicals. So stability actually deals with the thermodynamic stability. So thermodynamic stability means how stable is the product. So more stable the product, more will be the stability. So it depends upon the formation constant. Okay, formation constant or dissociation constant. So in case of this free radicals, tendency to dissociate into smaller fragment or rearrangement by bond breaking is known as the stability of free radicals. So the stability of free radicals that are oxygen and NO, they are highly stable free radicals, and this depends upon actually the bond dissociation energy. So more the bond dissociation energy, more will be the stability of free radical. And stability is directly proportional to the bond dissociation energy of the free radicals. Okay, so stability means we are talking about the thermodynamic stability, up to which extent the species, the free radical is stable. It cannot dissociate easily. If its dissociation energy is high, then the free radical is said to be a stable free radical. Now come to the reactivities of free radicals. So this reactivity is actually related to the kinetic stability. Okay, so kinetic stability, you have already studied that kinetic stability means how fast a substance can react. So if it is reacting fastly, so it is reactive species. Okay, so if it is not taking place in the reactions very fast, so they are less reactive species. So it is the ease of any species to undergo chemical reaction with the other species. So it is known as reactivity. A radical or ion may be reactive towards one substrate, but may be reactive with the other substrate. So they may react with one species at the same time, they cannot react with the other substrate under similar kind of reaction conditions. So the reaction conditions affect sometimes the other species which are present for the reaction. They affect the reactivity or kinetic stability of the free radical. So reactivity is the how, with the what is the ease of the reaction. Okay, so chemical reaction done by a species, if it is going with an ease, then it is a reactive species. If it is not going through the ease, so it is a non-reactive, its reactivity is less. Now we will discuss about the production of free radicals. So what are the different methods for production of free radicals? So if we categorize the mechanism wise, okay, so production of free radical can be categorized mechanism wise, and then that mechanism wise can further divide through the techniques of free radical production. Okay, so if we see, there may be two kinds of mechanism of free radical production. So one is homolytic fission and other is electron transfer. One mechanism that is homolytic fission, you have already studied that the covalent bond between these two atoms, it can homolytically cleaved so that one electron from this bond will goes to this atom and one electron will goes to this atom. So this is called as homolytic fission of covalent bond. Thus the free radical will be generated. So this is the mechanism of homolytic fission. And the other mechanism is electron transfer. So here one electron transfer can takes place. So the one electron transfer can takes place through this anionic species or through the cationic species. So if this anionic species this remove one electron, it can convert into a radical. Or this cationic species when accept an electron, it can converts into a radical. So this radical formation takes place through electron transfer, and generally it is one electron transfer, and this is known as the oxidation reaction, and this is a reduction reaction. So generally the generation of free radical takes place via cationic or anionic species when they undergo reduction and oxidation processes. Now the techniques through which homolytic fission can be done. What are the different processes that can be applied for homolytic fission? That are the techniques of free radical production. So these two are the mechanism. So this mechanism, how this mechanism can be generated? So there are certain methods, certain techniques which can be applied for homolytic fission of a covalent bond. So for the homolytic fission of a covalent bond, photochemical reactions can be done or photochemical fission can be done. So first technique through which homolytic fission of a covalent bond can be done is the photochemical fission. Photochemical fission means generally some molecules they absorb UV or visible light and form free radicals through homolytic fission. Like this hydrogen molecule, chlorine molecule, they absorbs light and then convert into radicals through homolytic fission. So this is the mechanism, but this mechanism can be done by certain methods. One of the method is the photochemical fission. Like this halogen, it can also absorb the photochemical light and convert it into bromine or chlorine or iodine free radicals. And sometimes this photolytic fission, they require some photosensitizers. Okay, so now this is an example of the photosensitized free radical generation. So this is a mercury vapor, and this mercury vapor, it is fully filled, it is having the fully filled electron, so its ground state is singlet. Okay, because its spin is zero, so 2s plus 1 is the multiplicity. So 2s plus 1, because s is equal to 0, so multiplicity will become 1. So this mercury vapor can absorb the 253.7 nm light and then it converts into the triplet state. Okay, so this is its triplet state. Unpairing will takes place, and this triplet state when reacts with hydrogen, this triplet state will homolytically cleave this hydrogen to generate hydrogen free radical, and then this species again generates this hydrogen radical and again converts into its ground state. So here this will acts as this mercury will acts as the photosensitizer, which sensitizes the homolytic fission of H2 molecule. So sometimes this kind of photosensitizers can be required for homolytic fission. Then the second type of technique which can homolytically cleaved the molecules for free radical generation is thermal fission. So we can apply some heat in place of light, then the weak bonds can be broken down at low temperature and then can form the free radicals. So like OO bond of peroxides and CN bonds in azo compounds, they are having weak bonds, so they can be thermolytically cleaved into radicals. Halogens can dissociated at low temperature, even at very low concentration. So very low concentration can also generate free radicals like the Cl2 at 975 degree, it can generate chlorine free radical, and bromine at 775 degree centigrade, it can generate bromine free radical. So these halogens at as we increase the temperature, they can convert it into the free radicals. Likewise, the persulfate ion can also homolytically cleaved at low temperature. So this persulfate ion, it can form the sulfate free radical. So thermal fission, we can generate the free radical via homolytic fission. The third technique is oxidation reduction reaction. So third technique is oxidation reduction reaction, where electron transfer will take place. So this can generate the free radicals, and it is also known as single electron transfer reaction, that is called as SET. The inorganic species that can change their valency can generate free radicals through this kind of mechanism. So the species like iron, which has two valency, that are plus 2 and plus 3, so because it can change in its valency, so it can generate free radical via oxidation reduction reactions. So the example is Fenton's reagent, which is a mixture of ferrous ion and peroxide. So this Fenton reagent is a mixture of hydrogen peroxide and ferrous, and then this ferrous can give its electron to this one of the OH, and thus form the OH free radical, and here will be the negative charge. So it will oxidize this iron to ferric ion. So because it has variable valency, so through this process, this free radical can be generated. Now tertiary butyl hydroperoxide also, when it reacts with Fe2+, it can again generate the free radical. Okay. Now the titanium, it can also generate free radicals, that is NH2. So this is a kind of oxidation reduction reaction where one electron can transfer to form free radical. One more method for generation of free radical is the electric discharge. So electric discharge can be used to produce SO4, ClO4, OH free radicals. So how this water in liquid or gaseous phase at high temperature and 1 to 3 mm pressure, it can generate OH free radical. Likewise, this sulfur and sulfur trioxide at 150 to 200 degree centigrade through electric discharge, they can generate SO free radical. So free radicals can also be generated through electrical discharge. Let's summarize the inorganic free radicals introduction part, generally part, where we have studied about the definition of free radicals and their nature, their state, physical state, their importance, and the difference between ions and free radicals. What is the difference between free radicals and ions? Now we have discussed in this lecture about the stability, that is thermodynamic stability, and the other term, that is reactivity, and that is related to the kinetic stability. So we have differentiated these two terms, and then we have studied about the production of free radicals that can be categorized according to the mechanism, and that is of two types, homolytic fission and electron transfer, and then some techniques can be applied for homolytic fission and electron transfer. So for homolytic fission, photochemical fission and thermal fission can be done to generate the free radicals, and then oxidation reduction reactions can be done, and electric discharge can be used for the production of free radicals. So this is all about the introductory part of inorganic free radicals. So thank you very much.